who's interested in doing meal prep? Cool. So, who can't be stuffed with meal prep? Cool. Yep, that's fine. It's all good. Here's my tips for meal prep if you do want to do it, though. So that you don't get bored, I'd plan 2 to 3 breakfasts for the week, so 2 to 3 different types. Might be eggs on toast, might be muesli and yogurt. Doesn't have to be fancy, okay? So plan 2 to 3 different ones for the week and just buy the things you need for that. Snacks, plan 3 to 4 snacks over the week and just buy the things you need for that. Lunch, 3 to 4 as well. Dinner, 5 to 6, because if we're cooking for other people, they probably want variety. Like, some people can eat the same thing every single day and are happy with that. Some people need variety, so do what works for you. But that's what would work for me. I'd get bored as. So 5 to 6 things for me. Or you can buy like a weekly meal planner or just make your own. And that's a really good way to look at it. If you've got it written down there and you've got written down, okay, so for morning tea, I have almonds and a small tub of yogurt. Then that's what you're going to have because you've kind of made yourself accountable. You're not going to bypass, oh, actually, all the girls are going out for coffee, so I'm going to go with them and I'm going to get the white chocolate macadamia choc chip cookie from Zaraffa's. No, you're not. You're going to have the yogurt and almonds, okay? Like, things like that. But find things you actually enjoy. Don't punish yourself through celery sticks if you don't like them. Don't do it to yourself because it's going to last a day and then you're going to have all these celery sticks chopped up in the fridge that you're going to throw out on Sunday, okay? Do things that you actually like. And if you need tips and stuff like that, let me know. I think we're going to write out a couple of different options and things like that and send them through to you guys. So, yeah, we're going to work on it. It's pretty much that. How am I going for time? Pretty good. Managing social occasions. Who finds this the hardest one to do? So difficult, okay? But here's a couple of tips. When you go out for dinner, order a salad starter, not bread. Gonna save stacks of calories. If you're in like a bulking phase and you want to gain some mass, probably go the bread option, okay? Or like a protein fueled option. At a barbecue, has anyone ever been to like a barbecue or an event where they walk around with the trays of the deep fried goodness? Yeah. So my top tip for that is the longer you can say no to that. So one is eat something small before you go. Like, don't feel like it's being stingy, just it's for your health. Eat something before you go. But also the longer you can say no to someone walking around for, the longer you're going to avoid it. If you say yes to the first one thing, you're gone for the rest of the night. It's how our brains work. You have one and it sparks the taste buds. And two, you go, ah, stuff it, I've had one, give me the plate. And you have the rest of them. So if you can avoid it for a while, then you might get through half the night. And cool, you've just avoided the first half of the night. As far as I'm concerned, that's a win, okay? It's not a loss because you gave in the end. It's a win for skipping that first part, okay? Don't punish yourselves for things like that. Social occasions are there to be enjoyed as well, okay? Get your better half or the kids or someone to grab them, wrap it in the napkin, and then you can have it later. Swap creamy pasta for tomato-based ones. Okay, that's a massive one that you can change. A big tip is ask for sauce on the side. So if you go out for breakfast and you get eggs Benny, ask for the hollandaise on the side. One, they give you less because the tubs are tiny. And two, you can choose the amount that you put on top. Same goes for salad dressings, anything like that. Often when we go out, they don't think about it being healthy. They're generally, very general statement, they're generally not olive oil, seeded mustard and balsamic vinegar in those ones. They're laden with sugar and things like that. Ask for it on the side. It still means you can have it, but just a little bit less. Swap chips for salad or veg. Everyone laughs at this one, but do a challenge with a friend. I've done this before, got on a little bit of a chip roll myself for a little while, and a friend was the same. And we said, okay, for 6 months, no chips, no hot chips. So you get into the habit of ordering, if you get a burger, that's cool, get the burger, ask for extra salad on the side instead of the chips. You save huge amounts of calories. Who goes to grilled? Yep. If you're looking to lose weight, you're way better off going there and getting just the burger and a side salad if you want, than what you are going and getting the low carb bun with the sweet potato fries. The just the burger is way better for you or lower in calorie than adding that silly little low carb bun, okay? That tastes like an omelet, not a bun. That's not a bun, okay? That's not how bread's meant to be. I really don't like it. I got it once and I'll never get it again. Oh, it's honestly, it's an omelet. It's not a bun. Okay. If you're going to someone's house, offer to bring something. Like if you know that they're the cheese and dip family or whatever, take cheese and dip that you think is a little bit healthier, like cheddar or like a harder cheeses have a lot less fat in them than the camembert and things like that, the softer ones. Take the cheese. Dessert, make something. Like I always take, surprise, surprise, the dietitian, I take like an apple and blueberry crumble. Everyone raves how good it is, but it's actually pretty healthy, okay? Still take along the really nice ice cream to go with it, but you've made one healthy choice. It's got good quality nuts in it, fruit, it's low sugar, it's got fiber, all of those kinds of things, and everyone's satisfied, but you know it's healthy, okay? And then they'll ask you for the recipe. They always do. Okay, another one, alcohol. Let's talk alcohol in social situations. You can save up to 300 calories with these swaps. Huge amounts of calories, okay? So swapping heavy beer for light beer, swapping like the soft drink Alco Pops, like, I don't know, like a cruiser, swap a cruiser for like a vodka lime and soda sort of thing. Swap a larger glass of wine for a smaller glass, if you're pouring your own, I mean. Offer to drive. I had someone recently told me that for the last 6 months they've offered to drive and they've saved so many nights where they feel terrible the next day, and also they've lost stacks of weight because it's the only thing they did. They've been out to lots of social occasions recently and that's the only thing they changed was their alcohol intake, and they've lost a couple of kilos over 6 months. Like that's massive. That's telling you something. Spirits. With soft drink, swapping them for just having it neat if you can, those kinds of things. Like they're obvious ones. Like we all know where the calories come from in alcohol. Yes, the alcohol itself has calories, but like creamy drinks, sweet drinks, full strength drinks, generally where it's going to come from. I'm quickly going to explain alcohol metabolism to you because I think it's really, really important. So you know how we're told that men can have one standard drink an hour and still drive a car, that kind of rule of thumb, and women one standard drink every 2 hours and should still be under the limit? That's based on, that's how they think that alcohol metabolizes in a body. They're saying that a man can metabolize one standard drink an hour and a female can metabolize one standard drink every 2 hours, okay? I kind of beg to differ. If I had one standard drink every 2 hours, there's no way I could operate a car, but anyway. So what it means is, let's say I had two standard drinks with dinner at 6 o'clock. So our bodies recognize alcohol as a toxin. So it wants to metabolize that before it works on any of the other macronutrients that you've eaten with dinner. So if I've had two standard glasses at 6 and I've had pasta with chicken and vegetables as well at that time, and then it was also in a creamy sauce, okay? So I had that with dinner. At 10 o'clock, I've just finished working off my two standard drinks. So at 10 o'clock when I'm in bed and I'm fast asleep, using the lowest amount of energy that I use in the entire day, that's when my body is going to start working off my creamy pasta. So if you think about a night out, boozy night out, you've had between 5 and 15 standard drinks. You've just worked that off in the entire next Sunday when you've also gone past KFC and had your really high fat food as well. And you wonder why when you start on Monday back at the gym, you're feeling really sluggish, the scales are up, all these kinds of things. It can take you like 3 days to get back to square one, okay? So just being mindful of that. What you're eating around your alcohol really does make a difference because of how long it takes you to work off the alcohol. Okay? So unless you're one who likes to walk home after a big night out, okay, think about it. Okay. So smart drinking tips. Choose the drink that you like and drink it slow. Mix with lower calorie mixes. So I do have a gripe with them, but I won't go on about it now. It's kind of like the low carb bun all over again. The sugar-free, add sugar-free and you're going to save a lot of calories. Use a small glass. So a small glass is going to make you feel like you're having a whole drink when it might only be a half standard drink. Have a water or a soda in between each one. If you're out, ask them to put some lime in it. Looks a little bit fancier. Big glass of water when you first arrived so that you make sure that you're not drinking to thirst. You're drinking to enjoy the drink. When you first turn up, you might not have had a glass of water or a sip of water for 2 hours before if it's taking you a while to get ready or whatever, if you've been running around. Have a big glass of water first. It's going to quench the thirst. Who drinks the first beer really, really quick? There you go. I rest my case. Okay. Hydration. This will be the last point that we'll go on for. So the importance of hydration. What's the story with alcohol? Cool, we've already typed it off. What's the best for hydration? Okay, so before training, everyone's really individual on what you can and can't tolerate. So keep that in mind when I'm going through this. And you can train your body to deal with more water on board or more fluid on board. So start well hydrated, 300 to 600 mils before a session. Okay. Practice is key, working on what's best for you. If you can't tolerate anything now, start with 100 mils in the morning and work your way up over a period of a couple of weeks to a month. Okay. During. So drink at a rate that's comfortable and practical for you. Sips every now and again. If you need to wait a longer period of time, whatever works for you. Carbohydrates. So this is what I was talking about before when I said I was going to contradict myself. If your session lasts for longer than 90 minutes, and particularly if it's in hot and humid conditions, you might need some electrolytes like Hydralyte in a drink, and you might need some carbohydrates like Gatorade or Powerade. Okay, so just playing around with what your session is tailored to be. Okay, plain water is often the best choice, so making sure that you have a drink bottle that you take to the gym or you take out to your sessions, making sure that you've got it there, better chance of drinking if you've got something available. Monitoring hydration. Has anyone ever monitored what their sweat rates are like? No? How you can sort of monitor those sweat rates, if you stand on the scales before a session and stand on them afterwards, if you've lost, for argument's sake and for my math's sake, 1 kilo, you need to replace that with 1.5 liters of water in the following couple of hours. So replacing 150%, okay? So just that's one way that we can sort of look at how much we've actually lost, because you're not losing body weight in that 45 minutes to an hour gym session. That's generally sweat rate.
Is that just water alone, or does that include like a protein shake and stuff that you have afterwards?
Oh, no, that includes that. Yeah, so if you have a protein shake afterwards, that's definitely included in your water intake. Okay. So dehydration signs, thirst, fatigue, headaches, poor concentration. So even if you're experiencing those in the afternoon at work or first thing in the morning, that might be a sign that you haven't replaced enough fluid after your training session. And a good simple rule is looking at the colour of your urine and just making sure that it's pale yellow. You'll know that you're well hydrated then. Don't freak out if you've had a Barocca though. Definitely different. Okay, so I don't know if you can see this very well, but I think this is a really good visual. So how much sugar's in the drink? Okay, we all know the Coke one, 9 teaspoons in 1 can of Coke, 7.5 teaspoons in one of those Lipton iced teas, juice, one of those small Just Juice poppers, about 3.5 teaspoons. Yes, it's coming from natural sugar. It's still sugar, okay? The Powerade, this is why I say, especially if your goals are weight loss, avoid like the things like Powerade and Gatorade. 7.5 teaspoons in that blue goo. Those vitamin waters, 5 teaspoons. A Red Bull, that's the one with the full sugar, obviously, 6 teaspoons. Boost juice, love this one, So a standard boost juice, 12 and a half teaspoons of sugar, okay? Not always the healthiest option. Coconut water, you can get some that are definitely sugar-free, but 2.5 teaspoons in one of those like little cardboardy box ones. iced coffee. Who has iced coffees? Yeah, cut that out and you'll see huge results, okay? One iced coffee a day in that standard size that you get from a servo, 11.5 teaspoons of sugar. And then just like the fruit drink, fruit juices, 4.5 teaspoons in a popper. Shocked? Yeah, you can save a lot of sugar just by not drinking it. Okay. And money, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like, what's a boost juice that size cost now? Like, it's ridiculous, isn't it? Like, $12 or something? I don't know. Yeah, still $7.50. Piece of fruit. You get an apple for like 60 cents or something, can't you? Okay, so it is a lot. It's a lot of sugar. Okay. Okay, last one. So you might be doing one of those things really well, or even two or three, but it is really about getting all of the pieces of the puzzle together for optimum health and for optimum recovery and all of your goals, okay? Rest is just as important in all of those. So important. So our bodies release a hormone called growth hormone in the first 3 hours of when we go to sleep, okay? If you're not getting a solid sleep in that first 3 hours, you might be missing the boat on that. Therefore, you might not be recovering as well as you possibly can, and therefore not reaching your goals. Okay, it's really important to get a good amount of sleep in. How much sleep do we need?
7, 8 hours,
that kind of thing. Recently, Usain Bolt told everyone that he sleeps for 11 hours a night. Amazing to have time to sleep for 11 hours a night. But for that's just going to show you, for someone who does do extreme exercise, you actually really do need that sleep. It's usually the one thing that people skip. Okay, really important. Cool. I think that's it. Does anyone have any questions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So usually they say 8 glasses of water. Day.
Yep. Yeah, I'd recommend around the 8. If it's hot, humid conditions and you're sweating a lot more, you're going to need a little bit more than that.
Yeah.
Okay, but yeah, standard rule of thumb, or sort of like the 2 to 3 litres.
Yeah.
What's a glass, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, but when you think about it, if you're conscious, you have a drink bottle next to you, you can get through it pretty quick. You can get through it in a day. And like the 3 litres is when, if you're up to training. So for a female, I'd say the 3 litres is definitely if you've had a training day. So 2 litres on a day when you're not using a lot of energy. And so talking for 2 hours, you expire one whole cup of liquid. So if you have a job where you talk a lot, you're using so much fluid, okay? So you really need to replace that. And also, if you drink tea, just tea, if you drink 5 cups of tea in a day, only one of those isn't counted in your intake of fluid, okay? So if you drink, so if you're drinking tea throughout the day, count those as your intake, okay? Just one isn't counted because of the diuretic effect. Sure, yeah. Yeah.
How do you go with, you say, like, have a piece of toast with some eggs or something like that? And you have a particular bread, so I always say, you know, brown bread might be better than white.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, so a multigrain that's on a wholemeal, like wholemeal multigrain, is the absolute peak of the best bread, okay? So, and again, it does depend a little bit on your goals, but a wholemeal multigrain is the lowest GI and it's got the most fiber in it, so it's going to be sustained release of energy throughout the day.